The message you're listening to is preached by Gustave Leroux from God Ministries. This message will greatly propel you, lift you up, heal the divine soul and spirit. It was ministered at the Hub in New Orleans. I know you will enjoy it. Please listen to the entire message. Subscribe and thank you very much. Have a great day. Bless you.
Faithful in what he has given you. And so the Lord is literally elevating you tonight to the next phase, the next dimension of your walk with Him. Matter of fact, I believe He's about to show you blessings for us. You're about to go into a place in the kingdom of heaven where He will begin to show you step by step everything you need to do, because there's a great reward for what you have walked in. And the Father said, I want you to receive everything I have for you. A dimension of righteousness, walking within the kingdom of heaven, operating from outside His heart, is the Father's desire for you. Father, I'm going to pray for blessing over them and ask you to just draw them deeper and deeper into your heart. Let them know you with levels that the natural capacity of what we've been taught will not fail. But let us go deeper than what we've ever been. Bless them, Lord. Thank you, Yeshua. Okay, so what I'm going to try and do tonight is, I don't know how it's going to work out, but how many of you ever listened or heard me speak? One of you, two, three, okay. How many of you are very new to the church?
New to the church.
New to church. Born again, recently. Anybody going once, going twice? Okay. Y'all are lying. But something changed my life. I've walked with Yahweh for a very long time, and I've always been very deep in everything I wanted to go into. Nothing is ever enough for me. In our ministry, we've raised the dead three times, and I need you to say, did you understand something? When I say we have raised the dead, that's biblical.
Yes.
Okay, because Jesus did not raise the dead. He used me to do it, and He wants to use you to do it. Matter of fact, He says in His word that you go and heal the sick and raise the dead in my name. And I need you to understand, it's not in the name of Jesus like we have learned it. It's within the name. It's the position that you're placed in. It's the authority given through what you are clothed in as you give your life to Him and you step into Him. Yeshua, the fullness of Christ. And the word Christ is the anointed one, which means yoke destroying, burden removing power of God. So when I get born again, I step into the light. I have become the fullness of the light. And I begin to operate in a different dimension. I am no longer the same. How many understand what I'm saying?
Yes.
I am no longer the same. I have a dimension of God that has reactivated a part of me that was dead. Because how many of you know that God's not a liar? Because if He says, if you eat of this fruit, you will surely die. Right, Genesis? And so they ate of the fruit, and then they didn't die. What happened? Something happened, right? Something died. Now, I just want to clarify some things before I carry on tonight. And I'm going to go to a level that you've probably never been to in church. Because we all believe, subconsciously, that death is our savior. Don't look at me with that tone. Because you were taught from the day you got born again that you can only go to heaven when you die. That you'll only be perfect once you die. Right? Okay, so when you start reading your Bible eventually one day, and you read what Yeshua did for us, that He torn the veil to go into that Holy of Holies, that through His blood and restoration was to restore me back into the kingdom of heaven, at the right hand of the Father in Christ, seated in heavenly places. It's an operational shift that the Father wants the church to go into. But we can no longer operate from here and expect the results that He wants to give the body of Christ, the ecclesia. So what I'm going to try and do tonight is I'm going to try to express and explain that when Adam and Eve ate of the fruit, how many of you know what happened immediately after? The Father came looking for them and He couldn't find them. And while He was looking for them, they took a fig leaf and knitted themselves some clothes. Yeah. So by the time Yeshua Yahweh found them, they were no longer naked. But yet, according to what they perceived, they were naked. Why? Because they were no longer clothed or covered by Yeshua. The covering that left because of the choice they made. I say they, I mean us. Because we were all in Adam and Eve. Right? So whatever mistake they made, we made. Then the Father makes a statement and says that He has skinned them. And our theology immediately takes us to a big fat lie that tells us that He sacrificed an animal. Is that your theology?
No.
Sacrificed an animal and clothed them with skins. Well, let me tell you something. When there's a sacrifice, there's atonement for sin. If there was atonement for sin, then there would not have been the punishment of death. But there was no atonement for sin. The punishment carried on. As a matter of fact, what happened, and if you go listen to your biology teacher, she will tell you that you have three layers of skin. So you are covered in skins, and because of your physical body, it's no longer being glorified. You no longer have access into the kingdom of heaven. That's why we were banned into the physical earth. We will work and toil this ground, right? Now we have to go through the process of getting born again. And the born again state reestablishes me back into my original place through the blood of Yeshua, where I then again enter into Him and I begin to live out of the place that I was born from. Because I need to understand the Father said, let us create man in our image. And then many, many scriptures later, He formed Adam out of the dust of the earth and blew the ruach into the nostrils and he became a living soul. So it's not quite the same. He created mankind. Because by the time you were sent into your mother's womb, you have already agreed to what you were called to in the earth. Now there's scriptures for all these things, but I'm not a mother. I don't know if any of my looks gives that up, but there's nothing about me that's mother. Right? Nothing. So I'm not going to spoon feed you, but we need to begin to understand the Father's desire for us is to reestablish ourselves through becoming born again. Now the original doesn't even say born again, it says born from above. Because I have to reestablish the life I lived before I was sent into the womb so that I can give my soul, which is my will, mind, and emotion, a memory recall of who I am to be in the earth. Yeah. It's too early for me to begin to lose you guys. Let me tell you something quickly, and I'm not trying to offend anybody. If you're feeling that it's cold and you're sitting a certain way, that's fine. But I'm going to give you an example. I've got these two guys in the gym, and they're talking to each other. And they're both sitting and standing in the same way. And I realized, just because of body language, that the one talking has no interest in what the other one's saying. Just because of the way they're standing. And the other one starts talking, and I realize that the way that he's standing and what he's doing, he's got no interest in what the other one's saying. And it is the folding of the arms. So I'm not urging you to stop that, but I'm asking you, if you don't understand what's coming out of my mouth, then you need to focus and pay attention. If there's a religious demon blocking you from what I'm saying, then you have to resist it. And it has to go. If there's just a deaf and dumb spirit covering on and over you, then it's cast away. But as the word of Yahweh wants to protrude into you, it's to give you life. It's to give you and take you to the next dimension of who you call to be. You guys okay?
Yes.
So, what I want to try and do tonight, I want to divide soul and spirit. Now the Bible talks about this in a couple of scriptures, but it focuses on it specifically when it comes to Ephesians, Hebrews 4:12. And the idea there is that the Word of God. Now we've been taught that the Word of God is the Bible, right? Now, I need to understand when the Bible and those in the Bible spoke of the Word, they were not referring to the Bible.
Yeah.
Right. That's just kind of logic, right? And don't get nervous. Because the Word of God has more than one dimension to it. And so when he says this, for the Word of God is living, that's something you need to remind yourself of and keep that in the back of your head. The Word of God is living and active and sharper than any two-edged sword and piercing as far as the division of soul and spirit, of both joints and marrow, and able to judge the thoughts and intents of the heart. So the Word of God is active and living and sharper than any two-edged sword. Now I want to just break it up very quickly, and I don't know how much time I have. I'm what you call a teacher. So my specialty is flappy lips.
We should go about 20, 30 minutes.
Well, that's impossible. My introduction is saying that. But I'll try it as quick as possible. So what I want to try and explain is that you've got the living Word. That's Yeshua. And everything that came out of Yeshua within the kingdom of heaven. That's why the blood restored me into Christ, that I can understand that he didn't die for me. And we need to seriously understand that he did not die for me, because that is legally impossible.
Right.
Now don't let this affect your theology, because if it does, it's just because your theology was wrong. But Jesus died as me.
Yeah, right.
He died as me so that I could live as him. So when I get born again, I step into him and I begin to live the life that I'm destined to live from outside of all that he's given me. It's no longer I who live, but Christ that lives in me. The life that I live by his faith in the Son of God. It's not even by my own faith. I live through his life and what he left in the earth for me. And it goes beyond what he's left, because he was and is and has always been. So I have the ability to constantly go back into that place and live and move and have my being in him at all costs and at all times.
Yes.
Are you guys okay?
Yes.
And then we have the spoken word. The spoken word is all the things that Yahweh said. The things that great men of God said. Now I need you to understand, when Yahweh speaks, or when an oracle of God speaks, it is that it's still a living word that protrudes out of, and that's called the Hebraic alphabet. It's the Aleph, the Taf, the Dalet. Okay, hold on to something. It's the fiery letters that's not part of what came out of Yahweh when he spoke creation into place.
Yeah.
It's a dimension of him that's in the word, that as we read it and it is illuminated to me, I can grab it and it becomes alive to me. It's more than just something I read. It's more than just a story. It is the living word. It's the written word that is alive to me. It's that which grows inside of me and begins to form me into the place that I'm supposed to be through the word and what the word's given me. Then we've got the Logos, which is the Bible, the written word. But the Logos is more than just the written. It is the mind of God through man. There's the mind of God through man, and that which man wrote, having the mind of God.
Yes.
Okay, so we are the only religion, by the way, that does not read our original script. We have translations. Right? Which steals from us. It takes from us. Because most of our translations today has taken out the Hebrew and replaced it with a Greek mindset, which takes out the supernatural, takes out the mysterious, the mysterion that the Father has placed for those who wants to go deeper. That's why it's key for you to study the Word in its original context. Are you guys okay?
Yes.
So if I have to, according to this scripture, divide my soul and my spirit, then something needs to change in me. Because I've been a Christian for 26 years, maybe less, maybe 24 years or 23 years. I got born in 95, so I'm 22 years born again. And for the last 6 years, I've lived a life divided soul and spirit. Which means for the last 6 years of my life, I have been in heaven every single day of my life for at least 3 to 4 hours every day. I have begun to see my Father, I have touched Him, I have sat with Him, I have walked with Him, I have eaten of fruit in Eden, I have been with angelic beings, I have met saints of old, I have spent time with seven spirits, I have spent time with the four living creatures, I have spent time with the 24 elders at the throne. Now don't look at me with that tone. You have to study, you have to read your Bible to know that all this stuff is available for all of us. His desire for us to go, but my spirit is bound by my soul. My soul is that part of me that was formed, trained, and equipped by that which is in the earth. So I got born into sin, not with sin. I'm born into sin, and then everything around me started shaping me. So my mother and my father, whether they were good or bad, they started shaping me. They shaped me with what they knew. So they did the best they could, but they still shaped me according to what their parents shaped them with and what the world they lived in shaped them with. So by the time I reach a certain age, I'm messed up. But I don't care who you are. You either are bound by religion, or you've got some kind of a perception, or God is this mean, nasty dude that wants to crush you, or and it's just all these perceptions, all these things, and now you have to begin to change that. You get born again, and how many of you understand after you got born again, there was this massive fight inside of you?
Yes.
Flesh versus spirit.
Yes.
But let me just say something. The spirit is who you are. I'm a spirit being. When you get born again, you're no longer a human being. You're a spirit being with a soul and a body. What's supposed to happen immediately is you're supposed to divide your soul and your spirit from each other, so that your spirit can immediately go into Yahweh, into the Father, where it comes from. That's the return, that's through the blood and the veil that was torn. But it can't happen because your soul and your spirit is one. Because your soul has drawn life from your spirit all of its life, and so it's become one. So the Word of God says that we have to use the fullness of the Word, every dimension of it, so that we can begin to break free, so my spirit, the true me, can operate and live within the kingdom of heaven. How are you guys doing?
Awesome.
So the idea of dividing soul and spirit is that you have to take the Word that's already in you, that which you've already meditated on, the relationship, the intimacy that you've already had with Yeshua. Now let me just throw this out there. Your relationship with Yeshua cannot be based on these two things only. If it is, it's divorce is due. I cannot only come to Him and ask Him to forgive me of my sins. How many of you understand that? It looks really good, especially in church, when the snot and the tears are running down your face. I'm so sorry. I love you, Jesus. Because I just committed some kind of a sin and I asked Him to forgive me, and I know He's willing to love on me and forgive me. And then I just do it again. Or is that just me? And then, of course, the other part that we do is we beg Him to supply our needs. Now, let me tell you, it looks really good because I'm always talking to Him. Sounds really great. So the bigger mess you live in, the more time you spend talking to God. That's a great, great, great way of looking at it. But that is not a relationship. If I have to relate that to my wife, I have the most amazing, most beautiful wife. Those who know her know what I'm talking about. She's just absolutely mind-blowing. She's given me 4 amazing little kids. She's a princess and I love her very much. But if I had to go to my baby and I say, Claire, I cheated on you again today with another woman. Other than the sound of that'll be one terrible experience for us. Then it will turn even worse when I go the next day and say, you know, baby, I love you so much. You're so awesome. You, wow. You know, but I did it again. I mean, I don't understand this. There's 2 days pushing it. With my wife, 1 day is pushing it. We don't have guns in the house, and she doesn't like guns. I love guns. So instead, I collect knives and swords. But I would be dead. There's no base for a relationship. Right? But we do this to God. And we think it's our relationship with Him. And we think it's okay. Now we think it's okay because my soul and my spirit is still connected. That's why you walk like this with your Christian walk. Up, down, up, down, up, down. Because your soul is constantly pulling you back because your soul was in charge. And your soul wants to constantly rule over your spirit. Because that's what it has always been doing. Now your spirit's in Christ, and the word that you're in, because Christ is the word, is busy dividing the two. Once it's divided, your spirit has full access into the heavens, and your soul and your body has to submit under your spirit, where your spirit is now on the throne, on the inside of you.
Yes.
How many of you know that you have a throne on the inside?
Yes.
Now, on the throne on the inside that you are sitting on, you are in Christ. So Christ on the inside of me is on my throne, and I'm in the inside of Him on the throne. Because I have to rule over my soul and over my body. They have to be subject to me as I'm subject to Christ.
Yes.
They can no longer do their own thing like I no longer want to do my own thing.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
And once I have begun to walk in that dimension, I begin to understand that something has to change. Because I go to my wife here and I say, maybe I just, when I'm finishing the bathroom, just put the toilet lid down for me, please.
Oh,
that's already a glitch just thinking about that. Standing, maybe the reason your feet are so small is because you need to stand so close to the oven. Right, that's why we need to touch your feet. Right, because she has to cook for me, and she has to clean for me, and this is what she must do, right? No. No, it's not my fault. No, I mean, that's not my base relationship. I can't say, baby, you know, I made this mess in my room, but don't you want to come clean it up for me, please? I mean, I understand, even in a marriage relationship, there's protocol. There's certain things you just don't do.
Right.
I do not cheat on my wife with another woman.
Right.
By the mercies and the grace of Yahweh and the commitment I've made to her, I don't ask her to do these things because I can do it myself. You know, and I trust that the relationship we have with Yahweh is more than just that. You know, I remember rebuking a son of mine, a spiritual son, and I said to him, I need you to stop reading your Bible. I told him to stop reading your Bible and stop praying. First of all, he was driving me nuts. Because everything that came out of his mouth was religious and I wanted to slap him. Even when he prayed, it was religious. It was just a babbling noise. And that was to me. I don't know what God thought of it. But it could have been worse to God. And I said to him, what you need to do is you need to go take out your favorite video. Unless it's porn. No porn. Take out your favorite movie and sit down and let you and Yahweh watch it together. And talk to Him about the movie. Because most of us cannot talk to God other than confessing our sins. And asking Him to supply our needs. And He makes it very clear in the Word that I've forgiven your sins.
Yeah.
That's not my focus. As a matter of fact, when I look at you through the blood of my Son.
Yeah.
And you're as white as snow.
Yeah.
When it comes to your needs, it's all been met. How much will I look after the birds in the air and the flowers in the fields? How much more will I look after you? So we need to begin to understand His desire is to propel us into a deeper dimension of intimacy with Him. And we've been taught that we can't see Him, we can't touch Him or feel Him, because if you see God, you will surely die. Man. I got that from my 11-year-old. I love you, my boy. Man. How was your day? Man. Okay, so, you know, I, as a Christian, am already dead. Now, if you don't know that, it's because you need to get born again. Because once I get born again, it's no longer I who live. Which means I don't have to die again to go to heaven. I have instant access, even through Christ, into the kingdom of heaven.
Yes.
I have instant access to being perfect. Because I've got a new DNA. I'm born into Christ. Now Christ was, the reason Christ never sinned was because He wasn't born into sin. He wasn't born into sin because of His bloodline. So when I'm born into Him, I get His bloodline and His DNA. I'm no longer the same. There's a dimension of me that changes. So when I begin to understand this, I don't just believe in a God that I can only hear. And then, of course, you have to be really, really, really mature and extremely spiritual to hear His audible voice. And there's only 10 people in the entire world that believe they've ever heard His audible voice. No, not really, but that's how scared it is. Because it's just what we expect and what we perceive of what and the way God speaks is so different. So the only way He can speak to us is through His Word and through our subconscious. That's what we believe. So this is a very weird God we have. He's spirit, I'm spirit. But I can't see Him, touch Him, or feel Him. I can only hear Him if I'm lucky. Does that sound right to you? Because when I start reading the Bible, I begin to understand that I'm seated in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. And Paul says that I was caught up into the third heaven. The third heaven, according to Paul was a Hebrew. He didn't say a Hebrew. He was a Hebrew. That was his language. That was his study. That's where he lived. That was his culture. So when he said Hebrew, he meant it in Hebrew. Three in Hebrew means Gimel. It's the letter Gimel. It looks like a camel humps. And it literally represents a camel. It means full supply. So he was said, I was caught up into the full supply of heaven. So that immediately eliminates the second kingdom that we believe and the first kingdom. The second kingdom in my theology, according to what I study, is the demonic realm that I have to look up to and break through to get to the kingdom of God. Yeah. Is that what we believe?
Yes.
Well, that does not gel with what I believe because He's under my feet. So if He's under my feet, the only rights He has is my toe jam. That's the only place He's welcome to.
Amen.
So and of course the Bible says that the kingdom of heaven is at hand.
Yes.
So it's not somewhere I go to, it's a place I shift into.
Amen.
So if my spirit and my soul is still attached, my soul cannot go. It can have a vision, it can have an encounter, and it can receive a gift and operate in these gifts, and it works well. But I know this could offend some, but the gifts are for babies. Because Jesus never operated the gifts. As a matter of fact, when the gifts was given through the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost, it was given as a measure, not a fullness. So if this next level is the fullness, and Yeshua is my example, and I begin to want to see how He did it. He operated in the Spirit and did phenomenal things. For example, they want to stone Him. No, they don't want to give Him something to smoke. They want to pick up boulders and crush His skull. Right? Is my time running out?
Go ahead.
Okay. So what happens is Bible says, and He walked right through them. Right? So our brief perception is, they must have made a path for Him. But it's funny because when He came back to that same city, there was revival. Because He walked through somebody. He walked through quite a couple and it freaked them out. Now out of the physical human being, and I need to remind you, Jesus was 100% man. He gave up His head so He could be my example. Right? So what He did, I can do. And how did He do it? His spirit was His host, not His body. Because He was a spirit being. That's why He's in the temple and they want to stone Him again. These guys, I'm telling you. And so the Bible says, and He hid Himself. And they could by no means see Him. Matter of fact, they could walk right by and not see Him. So what was our brief perception is, oh, He must have hid Himself behind a pillar. But He shifted into Himself. He shifted His soul and His body into His spirit and shifted into another dimension. Can we even fathom that? He heals the blind man. So He puts mud on him. And when he washes it up, he says, I see men that looks like trees. And then Jesus goes, oh wait, that's the wrong dimension. Let's do it again. See, the divine soul and spirit takes you into another place with Yahweh. I'm going to split right close. My ministry doesn't have an end. Okay. I've got 5 schools. He's been to some of my schools. Some of you guys have been to some of my schools. It is the one school in New Orleans we've been going through for 3 years. And we haven't even touched base on the revelations the Father's pouring in. So there's so much. And sharing one message is literally impossible. And I've refused to backslide when I preach. So I have to share it from where I'm at. Okay, so just hold up. I'm going to try and finish. So the idea here is, let me share your testimony before I carry on. I've been trying to invite soul and spirit. So it happened 6 years ago, and in the time that I was trying to go through it, I listened to a specific sermon that was discussing this in length, maybe 5-6 times a day for 9 months. It was a new revelation to me. I didn't understand it. I couldn't receive it. It was just beyond what I could fathom. Now, through this understanding, I can go into the kingdom of heaven. I can live and move and have my being there. I can see my Father. I can walk with my Father. I can see the angelic. I can walk with the angelic. I can engage with saints of old and men and women that has passed time that is in the kingdom of heaven. But we can't fathom. They go, men of and in white linen. Cloud of witnesses. There's just so much the seven spirits. I've walked with the seven spirits for the last 6 years. They have changed my life. They've taken me on journeys within this city. Dragons and giants have been slain. And the stuff that I don't even want to talk about because I can see the tone of your voice already. But so much stuff has happened. So much stuff has been revealed because my soul and my spirit is divided. I'm no longer a Christian like I used to be. I walk in the fullness of the light of the Son of Yahweh. There's a dimension of glory that comes with this revelation and the growth of who you are to become that goes beyond what we can fathom. Beyond than just being a meek and mild old son of a goat that's going to sin again and again and again. His life is always just going to be full of problems and issues. That's the church today, sick and dying baby. When I'm driving in a car, I'm living in South Africa, I'm driving in a car, I'm in America visiting, just preaching around some different churches, and we drive to South Carolina with a friend of mine, and I'm busy driving in a car, we're just singing and having fun in Yahweh and just praising and worshiping, and all of a sudden I hear a sound, and it's literally sounded like something breaking. It was that, and immediately my spirit stepped out of my body, and I could feel the wind of the car blowing on my spirit face. Then immediately after that, I had an encounter with the Father where He took me into the Spirit. I was sitting in the gym, funny enough, on the preaching call. That's funny because I'm a preacher. But it's range of biceps. So I'm sitting on the preaching call and I'm taken into the kingdom of heaven. And I'm going to try and close with this. I'm getting to a point. And the Father starts, He sits in His throne. And the angels surround, it's beautiful, it's phenomenal, I can't express it. The floor is a white, gray marble with a blue flame burning about it, but an inch and a half high. And of course, my instant reaction is, whoa, fire. It scares us, right? But I couldn't help myself because my spirit at this point just wanted to go. So all it wants to do, it immediately, when I invited the Holy Spirit, my spirit just wanted to go to the Father. It's like He had no choice, it had to go there. And I found myself at the throne, right in front of Him. But as I stepped my foot onto this blue flame, my entire spirit started burning with an orange, yellow, and red flame. And it was a non-consuming fire, but I could feel it burning me clean. By the time I got to the Father, I was so excited and so exhausted all at the same time. And immediately He got up and He anointed me and He did what He said He would do that day. And He took a sword, and the sword that He took, He anointed me with, and He put the sword back down, and the sword went into Him, and was Yahweh Yeshua, and He gave me a hug. And that's when I realized, when He hugged me, that was the first time I could breathe as a spirit. And I realized that's where I need to live and move and have my being. Now, I want to remind you that when you were not born again, and your spirit was bound to your soul, it just gave life. So you were literally a soul with a body. That's it. So when my spirit lives in the kingdom of heaven and does what it needs to do, it's aligned with my soul and the body as I engage with the Holy Spirit. Because the Holy Spirit is poured out onto all flesh. My soul and my flesh is one. Matter of fact, my body is slave to my soul. So when the Holy Spirit is engaged through the soul and the body, It aligns me so that my spirit can pour into it the revelation that is gaining and receiving from the kingdom of heaven. It's an dimension of understanding of who you are that enlarges you, that takes you into a new dimension. It's more than just being born again. It's more than just being healed by someone laying hands on you. It's stepping into the kingdom of heaven and you instantly healed. When I had asthma, now I've been an athlete all my life. In South Africa, I did professional wrestling. I was one of the strongman team leaders in Cape Town. I did all kinds of things all my life, and I get asthma. And funny enough, I received asthma by inhaling pure, fresh mountain air. Like, seriously? And it became really bad. I mean, I had to walk around with this pump all the time. I couldn't go to bed without using it. Wake up in the morning and actually use it. And where we stayed, the air was very thin, so it was getting worse and worse. And when the Father started taking me to the heavens, now, I say when the Father took me in, but it happens by desire. At will, whenever I want to go in, whenever I want to shift dimensions, I can shift dimensions because I'm a spirit being. But when I started taking my body into the kingdom of heaven, because it's just a dimensional shift, because the kingdom of heaven is right here where we are right now. The dimension of the kingdom of heaven is here, because it's not somewhere I have to go. I need to understand, God doesn't go anywhere. He's omnipresent. But he has places that has a greater dimension of his presence. But I presented myself to him and he's completely healed me. No one ever laid hands on me, and I no longer have asthma in any way, fashion, or form. See, what I want to do tonight is I want you to, if you don't have a revelation of this, I want you to, by faith, step into it. I've been teaching this for many years, 6 years. Say many years, I sound old. I've been teaching this for 6 years, and it has changed every life that has ever come in contact with this. It has changed my life. And this is just the very beginning of it. There's greater dimensions within the kingdom of heaven that we cannot even begin to fathom the Father's made available to us. Walking with the seven spirits has changed my life. They will sing, they have sent me on assignment within this city, within different cities, to do things that I never thought possible to do. Seeing things, and my sight is ridiculous. My encounter with the four living creatures about 6 weeks ago changed my sight to a dimension that I never thought possible. I have the ability through engaging with the spirit to see angels beings whenever I engage with them. I hear their voices, I hear them speak to me. They are one, there's a dimension of what we have missed as saints that the Father wants us to engage with. You know, we've been taught that you can't speak to angels. You can't name an angel. But how many of you remind yourself that we wake up in the morning and we start binding every demon we can see? And the ones we can't see. And we think that's okay. So what the church has done is we've surrounded ourselves with the demonic as we engage with the demonic. They love it. So when we start engaging with the angelic, and we start having that presence around, coming to every angelic being that's even here tonight, that's standing outside, that's walking the streets, that's looking after your body, has the presence and the fullness of the glory of the Father with him at all times. And matter of fact, they are the harvesters. They are the ones that brings in the salvation. And there's only one species that needs salvation. And the entire world, the entire created world is waiting for the sons of Yahweh to begin to walk in this. Yes. What I'm going to do tonight, I want you guys to stand. And when you stand, there's going to be an activation. The activation is your sight. Because how many of you understand this? The Bible tells us that if you're born again, you can see. So if you can't see, maybe you're not born again. But in the same breath, if you think you can't see, it's just the lies and the deception of the enemy. Because you can see. Right? See, now I know I'm going to offend someone with this. But every other Bible I've read other than the King James Version. Now I love the King James Version. They've got many truths and it's phenomenal. But 2 Corinthians 10, and that part of scripture is the only part that says all imaginations is bad. Have you ever read that in the King James Bible? If you read it in any other translation, it doesn't say all imaginations. Matter of fact, if you go to the original, it doesn't say imagination at all. because the word imagination wasn't there. So Satan's idea behind this is to steal your imagination away from you, because the Bible tells us that it's the eyes of your understanding being enlightened.
Yes.
So my imagination is the eyes of my soul. And when I start using my imagination, now let me remind you, you've got the mind of Christ. You might not feel like you have the mind of Christ, but that's the truth and reality of it. So when you start seeing things, you take what you see and you engage with it. You always walk with Yeshua. You remind yourself you're in Christ. You're covered by the blood of Yeshua. Satan has no power over you. And if he does, keep stepping into Yeshua. But the idea is that I begin to see through what my mind shows me. Because eventually it becomes so real, because I begin to understand it's really not what my mind is seeing, it's what my spirit is engaging with and showing to my soul. And when I start understanding that I'm a spirit being that is engaging in the Father's heart, walking in the heavens, the kingdom of heaven, experiencing all kinds of things, and the things that I'm imagining is really what my spirit is walking in and what my spirit wants my soul to know. It's an infused knowledge, an infused understanding that the Father is pouring to you. That's why the Bible tells us that He wants to be your teacher. He wants to train you. He wants to equip you. But we have theology. And theology comes from man, that came from man, that came from man, that came from man. That came from man. Now, I'm not opposed to theology. I did my bachelor's degree. I did my associate's master's degree. That's 7 years. Then I did 3 years at Bible school through my own mother church. I did 2 year Bible school at Rhema. And I did the school of ministry or supernatural through Bethel in South Africa, one of their satellite schools. That's 13 years of studying the Bible. Then all of a sudden these revelations came and it blew my theology right out the water. Because I no longer bind Satan.
Come on.
I go into that heaven, the courts, and deal with it there legally. But I can't remember the last time I spoke to him. He's a stranger to me. He can't attack me. He can't come against me. He's forgotten me and ran away from me. Because of who I am. But let me tell you, in the spirit realm, I'm 150 foot. When I walk the earth, every giant, every demon, every dragon in sight runs. Now I say, well, who am I? I'm just one in Christ like you. More than what we can ever begin to fathom. More than we can ever begin to understand. A one that walks as He does. And He says we'll do great things. Let's close our eyes. So I'm going to pray something, and I want you to listen to what I pray, and I want you to see it happen in you.
Yes.
Father, right now I want to bring every saint in front of me before your throne. So I want you to picture yourself at the throne. Whatever you think a throne looks like. And then remind yourself that in Christ you are pure, as white as snow. And the Bible says that only the pure in heart will see God. So you're not pure in heart in the natural, but you're pure in heart in Christ and through the blood of Yeshua. So you are pure. So you have the ability to see Him. Yeshua said, I don't do anything unless I see my Father do it. So I want you to see your Father on the throne right now. See yourself in front of Him. And Father, as we stand before you, I want to thank you and praise you and worship you. Let's exalt and magnify you for every life in front of me. And I pray right now, Lord, that as we begin to understand that the soul and the spirit needs to be divided so that the spirit can be with you and get taught and trained and equipped and get a memory recall from who it used to be and what it's agreed to be in the earth, that all that can happen. I pray, Father, that your word, I want you to see a sword in the spirit, and it will usually come out of the Father. Because it is Yahweh on the throne, and it's the fullness of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And Yeshua is in the Trinity. It will come out as the sword, and that is what you take, and you bring division between your soul and spirit. I want you to cut that cord right now in the name of Yeshua. I want you to do that all in your mind. Cut that cord. Let your spirit be free. Now remind yourself, your spirit's free in Christ, and it's led by His Spirit. It's led by the fullness of that which the Father has ordained for you. His desire for you is to take your soul and your body and subject it under your spirit. Let your spirit begin to rule over your soul and your body. I remind you, your spirit has all knowledge. Your spirit is perfect. It has no record or understanding of sin. Do you know that? It's your soul and your body that's bound to the earth. Your spirit was never part of it. It was dead. So the rebirth gives it a new dimensional shift. That's why there's a constant fight between soul and spirit. The spirit's pure. It comes from the Father. So right now, Father, as we've brought this division, this dividing, I pray that your glory will begin to fill up every spirit in this room. Every spirit man, every spirit woman, Father. I pray that that will reflect into the soul and the body. I pray, Father, you will align your sons and your daughters to a new dimension, a new level of understanding and revelation from your word, that which we read, that which you have spoken, and that which we engage with me and communicate with you. I pray, Father, that we will go deeper than just the milk, deeper than just the word. We will begin to eat of the mystery of your word, the mystery of what you have hidden away for those who go in deep. As many in this room that still needs to really commit to Yeshua, really give yourself over completely to Him. I urge you to make that decision in your heart. Because maybe you've prayed a sinner's prayer, but it's not something you love. But you know, I'll explain something. The Father does not bring condemnation. Satan hates you, and he brings condemnation. The Father brings you to a place of repentance so that you can turn and walk the other way. And it's through the Holy Spirit, and it's through your engagement. Father's desire for you is to live from within in the kingdom of heaven. To legislate the kingdom of heaven to the earth. That's our job. That's part of our purpose, is to legislate health, wealth, every dimension, every area of the kingdom of heaven to the earth. Father, right now I pray that there'll be a light switch that goes on in every life. That your spirit and your power will begin to hover over us, Father. Begin to draw us a deeper form of revelation, a deeper form of intimacy, a deeper form of who we're meant to be and called to be. Thank you. Praise you. In the name of Yeshua. So I want to speak over a couple of you that the Lord showed me. The elderly couple, I say the elderly couple, my apologies, but you guys in the back, you know what I'm talking about? The guy with the flower in his shirt, with his in his pocket, with his wife, and the other couple next to them. And the guys in the back row, not the very back row, just, yeah, if you guys can come forward, if you don't mind, like now. Wow. Is that okay? You guys, you don't mind if I do that?
No.
Wow. I don't know what the time limit is. Most people are going to understand it. Thank you. dimension of the life will be realigned. Every demonic oppression, suppression, go in the name of Jesus. Father, that peace that is living in her and surrounding her, and I'll look at her right now, that is phenomenal. Father, where she has been, where she is now, is two different people, two different places. There's a constant drawing, a constant pulling, and it brings great fear to her. And right now, Lord, I pray for shalom. You hit every aspect of her life, body, soul, and spirit, and to take her deep, deep, deep into you. And then the Father wants to show you in the spirit what's around you. What's around you is great destiny, wisdom, revelation, insight, knowledge. As a matter of fact, the Father is giving you a great, great understanding of things, and he will bring you to alignment. And that's that he's anointed with speech, and he's anointed with hands, and he's anointed with feet. The Father said, out of you will come great things. As a matter of fact, the Father is about to bring healing to your inner being to such an extent that what you speak will realign the earth. As a matter of fact, the teaching and training and equipping you from the human heaven, and then release life into your spirit that will bring life to those around you. You'll begin to understand who you are as a spirit being, and the power of allowing night in and around you, and you feel the fire of Yeshua burning, and everything you touch will shift into place. You will begin to understand what it means to walk in the fear of God. You will begin to understand what it means to walk in the spirit of the fear of the Lord. It will bring great awe and wonder to you, and you will begin to worship and exalt you from inside of you, in the spirit of God. Father wants to bless you and bring you great favor, and I speak that over you, and I speak into each other every night in your life. And I thank you, Father, for every approach that has been placed on her life, Father God, that which she has rejected, even the punishment that she brought over her body, Father, the hate that she had on her heart for herself, and the healing that's coming even as we speak. And I'm sure that I thank you and pray for that she has. Amen. 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 Can you guys? Raising them up, taking them in the process. They need to understand that they cannot be punished. that's directed on both of you and come from the King of Heaven. And yes, it will be reflected as a sound, because that's most of the frequency for our ears. But the follower shall begin to understand that the frequency that you release does not just bring the anointing, bring the glory over to the wall, bring the forms of his presence, because of what you do, you open your mouth, singing. It's there because of who you are, what you carry. It's what you've agreed to before you ascend into the Most Holy. It's a dimension of his glory that's placed inside both of you that you carry as one. And he wants to increase that. You will feel over the next couple of months how the frequency, the vibrations inside of you increase. Your worship will change. The way you sing will change. Your voice will change. The way you play the instruments will change. There'll be a shift almost every 6 months. There'll be a shift in the sound. And the Father says the reason being is because I'm increasing the frequency. I'm increasing the frequency. Because the frequency is the beat, the heartbeat of Yahweh. It's when the Holy Spirit hovered over the earth. It's when the Holy Spirit hovered over Mary. And there's certain things that happen. It's creation that took place. And so your music will bring that vibration, that frequency that will bring healing. Literally, people will just jump out of the vision. Eyes will pop open, ears will pop open. And it won't be because of gifts. Don't be because of offering out of the gifts in every fashion and form. Being in the Spirit and aligning the kingdom of heaven on the earth through the frequency that is inside of you, and the engagement with the Father will constantly increase. And of course, it's up to you, the Father's desire for both of you, is to find yourself in the Spirit, in the kingdom of heaven, walking with Him, talking with Him, spending intimate time with Him, separately and together. Finding yourself just going on assignment to the seven spirits, finding yourself engaging with Him as well, finding yourself allowing every portholder that's broken. You go into it, you just receive what the Father has for you. There's great intensity that the Father has placed in your life. There's wisdom and revelation and knowledge that He's about to give you and show you and place it together to lead you into that you never on your own go into. The Father says, I've given you everything you need, and you never need to be afraid. There will be a visible glow around you that will be your protection. As a matter of fact, you each have a bloodline angel, which is archangels assigned to you. Angel I have, his name is Ezekiel, is assigned to my bloodline. I speak to him all the time. He's a very powerful angel. I've got two angels on my side. It's called passion and focus. They're always there. They are very chatty. And you'll begin to engage the angel that's around you here. But one massive prince angel that is assigned to your bloodline is an archangel. There's more than three archangels. I urge you to ask him for his name so you guys can begin to engage with him. There's a lot of protocol, this will follow, teach you all these things. There's so much that he wants to teach you. He's excited because there's been a shift in your heart and desire that's open tonight. And so as you begin to go deeper, he will reveal great secrets, great mysteries to the both of you. But it has to come from the both of you because you are the key. You both, you are the key within the kingdom of heaven. And the Father wants to give you place. You as the gate, as the door in the right place, and the mountain can be occupied. That which the enemy has held back has to be locked and stopped so that what's supposed to come through the two of you into the earth has full fruition. Well, I pray that there'll be understanding on this word and that you'll begin to just take them deeper and deeper into who you are. In the name of Yeshua. Amen. Because there is wisdom and revelation within that has not been spoken. In fact, you have revelation in your heart that you've had fear in your heart to share with others because of the extreme heart. But let me tell you, that now is a time and a season to begin to share those mysteries. Begin to share what the Father has placed in you, because it's not going to be as obscene as what you think it is. Just because it doesn't have to align, doesn't align with man's perception of the word, doesn't mean it's not God's perception of the word. So I need you to begin to understand that the Father is about to release you into the fullness of what's available for you, according to what you've been destined to do. I believe that the Father wants to break open the dimension of finances in your life, open doors, and begin to pour in more than what you ever expected or thought possible. Because I see the Father has looked upon your faithfulness regarding the way you operate in the book of finances. So Lord, I just want to ask you right now, let me assure that you will propel these two into a deeper dimension, even the knitting together of course, that together these two needs to become even closer than one another. I pray that there will be a dimension of intimacy between this relationship that will grow deeper like it was in the beginning. Lord, I pray that you will consume them with your presence, Father. I pray that their house will be consumed with your presence, Lord. I pray that they will begin to understand the fullness of your presence and how deep you want to take them in to the knowledge of who you are, Father. I thank you that you're busy healing every aspect of their lives, Father. God, I thank you that which needs healing right now, the world will be given, Father, in every aspect and area of their lives. Lord, I thank you that the medication will begin to become less. I don't know why I see that. I might be wrong. I just feel that there's a high blood pressure from some side of my lung. What if you have high blood pressure? You have high blood pressure, yeah. Okay, so the Father says is you're going to begin to see that your blood pressure will come subside, because you will begin to enter deeper into the Father's heart. You will begin to see what the Father is revealing to you, and you will step in, and you will begin to take less and less medication. And there's got some other medications that you take as well, and the Father says you're going to begin to see how this thing is just going to set itself aside, because it's really healing you. It's really taking you deeper into his throne, beginning to just show you the love that he has for you. And he's taking you to places that you never thought possible. He wants to bring you revelation inside regarding who you are in your ministry and who the Father's called you to. And he's just constantly going to wash you and take you deeper and deeper into his throne. Both of you, the Father is called to great things. And he will constantly show you the light, and he will lead you deeper and deeper into these revelations as you engage with him at higher levels. What is your name? Preston. My Father loves you excessively. Matter of fact, he's crazy about you. Torments you with forced suicide. abuse, the violence, the aggression, the rejection that you've walked in. We cut them off from you and command them to go in the name of Yeshua and the force of His glory to consume you and the blood of Yahweh to fill you up, to realign you into who you're meant to be. Because this is the time of the season where the Father will show you who He is. And He's going to begin to run on you to the places that I mentioned to never fall apart. They're the same people to love and bless you as you never fall apart, like He's already done here. The Father is going to continue to open doors for you and bless you, because this is your season and this is your time.
Yes. Amen.
Bless you. So the Father wants you to understand what's going to happen in the near future, how He's going to avoid it.